man.
Okay, right. Shall we start the class? Shall we start the class?
Yes.
Then mute your audios. Okay. Right. We'll start class. Today's class is about stomach. Okay. Have you had your food, all of you? Okay. Right. Very good. So today's class is about the stomach. So we'll be dealing the stomach under following headings, and it is very important question, essay question, or sometimes it may be as a short notes also. Like they may ask about the blood supply of the stomach or lymphatic drainage of the stomach. Okay. Then sometimes as an essay question. So keep listening. Don't distract yourself. Okay. So we'll be dealing under introduction, location, situation, and extent. Capacity, shape, external features, which includes the parts, relations, internal features, blood supply, nerve supply, lymphatic drainages, and clinical aspects. Okay. Right. So, introduction, we have, you know, what is the meaning of the stomach? Stomach is a Greek derivative. Stomachos means mouth bag. Okay. It is also called as gastric or ventus. It's the most dilated part in the digestive system. It extends from the cardiac end to the pyloric end, and this muscular bag continues above with the esophagus and below with the abdomen. Functions of this stomach is, you already know that it is acts as a reservoir of food. It can retain food as 3 to 4 hours. It depends upon the food what we take. Either if it is a carbohydrate meal, it will be emptied into the duodenum or small intestine very fast. Protein, it takes a little bit more time, whereas the fatty food, it takes still more time. Another functions, like it is helps in mixing the gastric juices. The muscle of the stomach, the wall of the stomach, has 3 types of the muscles. So they help in mixing up of the food with the gastric juice and forms the chyme. The HCl, which is present in the acid, gastric secretion, or the acid medium in the gastric juice, will kill the bacteria which is ingested along with the food. Apart from that, it also secretes the intrinsic factor called as casein, intrinsic factor of casein, which helps in absorption of the vitamin B12 in the small intestine. It also controls the rate of propulsion of the chyme into the duodenum. Proper helps in proper digestion and absorption of the food what we eat. Those are the functions of the stomach. So coming to the location of the stomach, it is occupying the left upper quadrant of the abdomen. Or exactly speaking, it occupies the left hypochondriac, epigastric, and the umbilical region. So in this picture, you can make out the 9 divisions of the abdomen. Based on that, we can see 2 vertical lines called as the midclavicular lines and 2 horizontal lines called as the transpyloric line and transtubercular line. Upper horizontal line is called as transpyloric and lower horizontal line is called as the transtubercular. So based on this, 2 vertical and horizontal lines, they are divided into 9 quadrants. So our stomach occupies the left hypochondria, okay? Then the epigastric region and the umbilical region. So it extends obliquely from the left hypochondria to the epigastric region. And most of the stomach lies under the left costal margin under the lower lip ribs. Coming to the shape of the stomach, in the cadaver, the stomach is sickle shaped. And if in the living persons, the stomach is J-shaped, and usually it is oriented a little bit obliquely. The long limb of the J is oriented a little bit obliquely. So this position is called usually the normal position. Hello? So this position is called as the normal position. So we call it as sphenic position. It is seen in 50% of the cases. Whereas one more condition is called as hypersthenic position or Steinhorn position. It is where we can see in 5% of the individuals, and the position of the stomach is more transversely or more obliquely presented. And these type of persons are more prone to the duodenal ulcers. One more condition is hypostenic condition, and there the vertical limb of the J or the stomach will be elongated and narrow, extending more downwards, right? So in that, the person are seen as 35% of the cases, and they are more prone for the gastric ulcers. So if you see the size of the stomach, it can be distendable. It is more distended. So normal size is about 25 centimeters or 10 inches. And the capacity in case of newborns, it can accommodate 30 to 50 ml of fluid. In case of the puberty, at the time of puberty, up to 1,000 ml of fluid. Whereas in case of adults, it is 1.5 to 2 liters. And the capacity can be as much as the stomach. So you can see so many pizzas and burgers are there. So if you are more favorite or if you like those things, right, you will be having more pizza and burgers. So the stomach capacity is variable. And coming to the external features of the stomach, you can see it consists of two orifices, so which you can make out by two arrow marks. The upper part is called as cardiac orifice, and the lower arrow indicates the pyloric orifice. And you can see two convex, one convex and one concave curve. So the concave curve is called as the lesser curvature of the stomach, and the other one is convex, that is called as the greater curvature of the stomach. And the one facing towards you, the surface of the stomach, is anterior superior, and the other one posterior to it is called as the posterior inferior. As we said, it is not standing or positioned vertically downwards. We said the stomach is obliquely present, and the anterior surface will be facing, it will be facing forwards and upwards, whereas the posterior surface is facing posteriorly and downwards. So we call it as anterior superior and posterior inferior surfaces. So external features of the stomach, two orifices, two curvatures, and two surfaces. So two orifices are cardiac and pyloric orifice, two curvatures are lesser curvature and greater curvature, whereas surfaces are called as anterior superior and anterior inferior surfaces. So if you see, that is the cardiac orifice. So sometimes in the exams, we'll have the surface marking of the cardiac orifice or surface marking of the stomach. So we have to mark the cardiac orifice and the pyloric orifice. Then we have to join with the one concave and one convex lines indicating the position of the stomach. So see the cardiac orifice. So surface marking, it is about 2.5 centimeters to the left of the midline. So it is just behind the seventh costal cartilage, opposite to the T11 vertebra. It is 10 centimeters deep to the anterior abdominal wall. So we measure, it is again one point we have mentioned there, that is 40 centimeters away from the incisor. So this is related or according to the esophagus. So when we are putting Ryle's tube through the esophagus, we have to know whether the Ryle's tube is inside the stomach or not. So we have some distances from the incisor teeth. So once it reaches particular level, we think that is near the bifurcation of pulmonary trunk or arch of aorta. Then at one particular distance means we think that it's near the lower end of the esophagus, or after that we can understand that it is inside the stomach. So for that sake, they have written like 40 centimeters away from the incisor teeth. Then coming to the relations of this cardiac orifice, anteriorly it is covered by the peritoneum, and it is related to the left lobe of the liver. So you know liver has two lobes, right and left lobes. Left lobe is very small, extending into the left hypochondria. So there it is related to the left lobe of the liver. Posteriorly it is non-peritoneal, and it is related to the bare area of the stomach. So we call that part, small part which is not covered by the peritoneum, we call it the bare area of the stomach, and it is connected to the left crest of the diaphragm. We call that part of the peritoneum as the gastrophrenic ligament. Pyloric orifice. So the lower part where the stomach continues with the duodenum, first part of the duodenum is the small narrow constricted part, we call it as pyloric orifice. It is about 1.25 centimeters to the right of the midline, opposite to L1 vertebrae. So it means L1 vertebrae is at the level of transpyloric plane. So first, I have shown you first horizontal line. So it passes along the transpyloric or at the lower border of the L1 vertebra. We can identify this pyloric orifice by tracing a vein called as the pre-pyloric vein of Mayo. Pre-pyloric vein of Mayo in case of living individuals. So if the, in case of obese or fatty person, if you are not able to identify, just trace the pre-pyloric vein of Mayo, which is unpaid. It is not accompanied by the artery. So it is an unpaid vein. So once you reach, trace the pre-pyloric vein of Mayo, you can trace the pyloric orifice. relations of this pyloric orifice, again, it is covered by the peritoneum and it is related to the quadrate lobe of liver. Posteriorly, it is related to the neck of the pancreas. So you can see the arrow placed near the neck of the pancreas in the lower picture, and it is separated by the space called as the lesser sac. Whereas the anterior relation, it is separated from the space called as greater sac. Because when I'm saying space means in the abdomen also, we have a cavity called as peritoneal cavity. How we had pleura and pericardium. Similarly, abdomen also has peritoneum. Peritoneal cavity is there. Again, because of these organs, cavity will be reduced to small space and having inner visceral layer and outer parietal layers. So, and we know the rotation of the gut also, because of that, peritoneal cavity is divided into a greater sac and the lesser sac. So lesser sac is behind the stomach, whereas the greater sac is occupying the maximum part of the abdominal cavity. Then coming to the lesser curvature. So you can see green line there, that is called the concave. So it forms the right border of the stomach. Okay, it attaches, it gives attachment to a fold of peritoneum called as the lesser omentum. Within this fold of peritoneum, we have anastomosis of two branches coming from the main celiac tongue, that is called as the right and left gastric arteries. Left gastric artery is a direct branch from the celiac tongue, whereas the right gastric comes from the hepatic artery. Both of them anastomose. The function of this anastomose, or what is the function of that vessel, is to supply the stomach. And then next is the greater curvature. So this is the left border of the stomach. So it attaches, it is the left border of the stomach. You can make out the arrows indicating there, the greater curvature. Along the greater curvature, we have the attachment of the peritoneum. Again, they are divided into gastrocnemic, gastrosplenic ligaments and the greater omentum. So you can make out one arrow showing you the curtain-like appearance here. The curtain-like appearance in this part. Right, this is called as the greater omentum, which is attached along the greater curvature. So gastrocnemic ligament is the one which is attaching the cardiac end of the stomach to the diaphragm, whereas gastrocnemic ligament is the one which is attaching the fundic part of the stomach to the spleen. Okay, so those two are called gastrocnemic and gastrosplenic ligaments, and the one which is all along the greater curvature is called as the greater omentum. And within the greater omentum, you have the anastomosis of two arteries called as right and left gastroepiploid arteries. And so here in this picture, you can make out the greater omentum attached along the greater curvature, lesser omentum attached along the lesser curvature, and in the along the greater curvature, you can also see the gastrocnemic ligament, gastrosplenic ligament, and the remaining part is the greater omentum. So the one end of the greater omentum is attached to greater curvature, remaining lower and free margin is covering the anterior part of the abdomen. So it is also known as the policeman of the abdomen. Greater omentum is called as the policeman of the abdomen. Since it consists of macrophages, any infection is there in the abdomen, it moves towards that and localizes the infection. So that's why it's called as the policeman of the abdomen. Whereas the lesser omentum is mostly fixed because one end is attached along the lesser curvature, the other end is attached to the liver. Whereas this greater omentum, only one end is attached to the greater curvature. The remaining is free end. Then coming to the anterior superior surface, so it is completely covered by the peritoneum. Posterior inferior surface, it is also covered by the peritoneum. So in this picture, we have lifted the stomach here. You can make out the stomach is lifted to show you the posterior inferior surface. Posterior, this is the posterior inferior surface here. And the part here, what you are seeing, we call this as the lesser sac. This one as the lesser sac. This is called as the behind the stomach, the space of part peritoneum, the peritoneal sac, we call it as the lesser sac. And coming to the fundus, so you can make out the fundus dome shaped. So how to demarcate from the body means we have to draw an imagine horizontal line from the cardiac notch. So you can make out the cardiac notch here, cardiac end, cardiac notch, and dotted line passing horizontally. It separates the fundus from the rest of the body of the stomach. So this is the fundus part. So it is always filled with the gas. So even if you have food in your stomach, or if you don't have, it is empty also, it will be always filled with the gas, and the maximum amount of gas can be occupied in the fundus part is about 50 ml, which can be seen in the radiographic x-rays. So since this fundus extends till the 50 intercostal space just below the left side nipple, okay, left nipple, so sometimes there are chances of, if there is a gastritis, then also we may think that there is something pain, and we can say that this mimics the angina pectoris, means some problem with the heart. We may think that. Otherwise, we have to rule out it may be because of the gastritis. Then body is in between the fundus and the pyloric part of the stomach, and it is the largest part of the stomach. Then coming to the pyloric part. So pyloric part, how to demarcate? Otherwise, we can also say the stomach is divided into two parts, that is called as the cardiac part and the pyloric part. So here you can make out one name called as the incisura angularis. Incisura angularis along the lesser curvature, which is the most dependent part of the lesser curvature. So this line is called as incisura angularis, which divides the stomach into cardiac part and the pyloric part. So the cardiac part is again divided into the fundus and the body, otherwise called as the corpus. Whereas the pyloric part is divided by an inconstant sulcus, which is extending from the greater curvature, from here, which divides that inconstant sulcus, which is extending from the greater curvature, this one. Okay, this is called as the sulcus intermedius, which divides the pyloric part into pyloric antrum and pyloric canal. So this whole pyloric part is about 10 centimeters. The pyloric antrum is about 7.5 centimeters, whereas the pyloric canal is about 2.5 centimeters. So this pyloric canal continues with the first part of the duodenum, which is guarded by a valve or a sphincter called as the pyloric sphincter. Then coming to the relations of the stomach, we have both the peritoneal and the visceral relations. In this diagram, you are able to see the lesser omentum along the lesser curvature connecting to the liver, the greater omentum along the greater curvature, and the loin cut sections, where we can see the peritoneum is covering the anterior superior and the posterior inferior surface of the stomach. So here you are able to see the stomach. So upper blue line is the anterior layer of the peritoneum, and behind blue line is the posterior layer of the peritoneum. So below, from the lower border or greater curvature of the stomach, what you are seeing is the greater omentum. Lower border of the stomach, what you are seeing is the, this is the greater omentum of the stomach. So along the greater curvature, we have first two layers of the greater omentum. As you know, greater omentum is made up of four layers. First two layers are attached to the greater curvature. The remaining will be going backwards. So in such a way that first layer will be continuing with the fourth layer. Second layer continues with the third layer of the greater omentum. So the third and fourth layers goes to the posterior abdominal, or it gets attached to the anterior border of the pancreas, then goes to posterior abdominal wall, and again returns back to enclose the transverse colon. Okay, so in that way we have the covering of the peritoneal relations. So in this diagram also you can make out the cross section of the peritoneum covering the stomach, forming the gastrosplenic ligament, gastrophrenic ligament, lesser omentum, and the greater omentum. Okay, coming to the anterior relations, visceral anterior relations. So in the anterior visceral relations, we have the stomach is related to the anterior abdominal wall, the left lobe of the liver, where we have the gastric impression, the transverse colon, left lung, left pleura, pericardium, heart, and left side, 6th to 9th costal cartilages and the intercostal spaces. So since our stomach is related or located on the left side of our abdomen, so we have to write all the left side, that is left lung and pleura. Left side, we have pericardium and the heart, left 6 to 9 intercostal spaces and the 6 to 9 intercostal costal cartilages and the costal intercostal spaces. And posterior, in this related to the anterior surface or anterior superior surface, we have two important areas, what we call it as the trabis area. This trabis area is topographically overlying the fundus part of the stomach. So this trabis area is overlying the fundus part of the stomach, and this area, because fundus means, again you have to remember, it is occupied by the gas. Okay, so on percussion we should hear a resonant sound or tympanic sound. Okay, whereas in case of splenomegaly or pleural effusion, instead of hearing a resonant sound, we may hear a dull sound. Okay, so because that part is obliterated because of expansion of the pleural effusion or splenomegaly, that part is obliterated. So we don't hear the resonance or the tympanic sound. Okay, so what are the boundaries of this trabis area? So superiorly, you can make out it is quadrangular in shape. So trace properly those four blue lines what you are seeing. Okay, and arrow indicated in the trabis area. So superiorly, you have the lower border of the left lung. Inferiorly, the left costal margin. On the right side, lower border of the left lobe of the liver, and on the left side, the lateral end of the spleen. So that is the quadrilateral in shape. So above we have the left costal margin, below we have the left costal margin, above is the lower border of the left lung, on to the right we have the lower border of the left lobe of the liver, on to the left we have the lateral end of the spleen. Why we are saying lateral end of the spleen? Because the spleen also has upper end and lower end. Lower end is again it is placed obliquely, so the lower end comes towards the midline. Okay, so that is the boundaries of the trabis area. One more important area is the gastric triangle also will come across. Before that, we see the relations of the posterior surface of the stomach. So here, the posterior surface of the stomach, in supine position, we have some organs related to the stomach which are separated by the lesser sac. They are separated by the lesser sac. So in that, we can remember by a mnemonic called as the Dr. SSS kills patients mercilessly. This is a mnemonic we can remember like Dr. SSS kills the patient mercilessly. So in, I have not written in an order, I have written in this mnemonic only. Dr. D for diaphragm, this is for the left suprarenal, L is for the left colic or the splenic flexure, S is for splenic artery, anterior surface of the left kidney, anterior surface of pancreas, transverse mesocolon and the spleen. But here the spleen is separated by the cavity of the greater sac, or the spleen is separated by the greater sac, whereas the remaining all organs what we have mentioned, that is from the diaphragm, suprarenal, kidney, spleen, pancreas, transverse colon, transverse mesocolon and the splenic flexure. All these are separated by the cavity of lesser sac, whereas the spleen is separated by the cavity of the greater sac. Are you getting me? Are you getting me? Please response. Okay,
yes, ma'am.
You are following me. No problem in following. Thank you. So those are the posterior relations. Instead of saying posterior relations, we may also say stomach bed. This will be in the posterior when the person is on the supine position. Okay, coming to the interior of the stomach. If you see interior of the stomach, we have already we have finished in the histology, right? We have the mucous membrane is thrown into folds, what we are calling it as rugae, temporary folds, because they may be disappearing when the stomach is distended with the food. And apart from that, along the lesser curvature, these rugae are horizontally, longitudinally present. So we call that as gastric canal. Please mute your audio. Somebody mute your audio. Mute your audio. Right, thank you. Then we have in the mucous membrane small openings, what we call them as the pits. And into that we have the openings of the gastric gland. So the wall of the stomach is made of, you know, the mucous membrane. So thick, soft and velvety in appearance. And so this rugae will be disappeared when the stomach is full and distended. And when they appear, when it is empty, the glands will be opening into the gastric pits. Okay, so this is a histological diagram. You may be, if you have forgotten, you know where the pits are seen. See here, I am putting the arrow there. That is the pit, gastric pit. So it is, you know, the pits are shallow and deep, right? Deep in case of the pyloric part of the stomach and shallow in case of the fundic and the cardiac part of the body of the stomach. So this is the cells, what we can see in the mucous membrane or epithelium lining, columnar epithelium. Apart from the chief cells, parietal cells are seen. Right? Then you can see along the, I told you, along the lesser curvature, the mucous membrane or the mucous folds are longitudinal, so we are calling that as the gastric canal, otherwise called as the gastric canal of Meigen's striae. Okay, so this is because of the, again, we have to know about the muscles of the stomach. So the oblique muscle, we have long outer longitudinal, inner circular, and the innermost oblique group of the muscles. Okay, so this again one more point is the mucous membrane is tightly adherent to the muscular layer of the stomach in case near the lesser curvature of the stomach. So because of this gastric canal, whatever fluids we swallow, they will be passing along the lesser curvatures. They won't occupy the remaining part of the stomach. They straight away pass along the lesser curvature and enter into the duodenum. So this part of the lesser curvature along that, it is subjected to a maximum insult of because of swallowing this eating of spicy foods or the irritable liquid. So there are more chances of occurrence of the gastric ulcerations. Then submucosa, of course, we know it consists of some loose areolar tissue, blood vessels, nerves, and the lymphatic. So already we have, I told you, the muscular, so it consists of the outer longitudinal, middle circular, and the inner oblique muscle fibers. So the longitudinal muscle fibers will be continuous with the longitudinal muscle fibers of the esophagus. Okay, so we don't find any sphincter there. Cardiac end we are seeing, but we don't find any sphincter there. But physiologically, we come across the cardiac sphincter there. Anatomically, we don't find, since the longitudinal muscles are continuous with the longitudinal muscles of the esophagus. But in case of the lower part, near to the pyloric end of the stomach, the longitudinal muscles of the stomach, they split into superficial and deeper part. Superficial continues with the duodenum, longitudinal muscles of the duodenum, whereas the deeper muscle fibers, they will join the circular muscles and be thickened to form the pyloric sphincter. So there, near the pyloric end, the anatomical and physiological expression of the pyloric sphincter can be seen there. Okay, then the circular muscle fibers, they are forming thickening along the circular muscle fibers. Also, they continue with the circular muscle fibers of the esophagus, whereas they form thickened, they form the pyloric sphincter near the pyloric end of the stomach. And the oblique group of muscles, they are inverted U-shaped. They are all around the body of the stomach and the fundus of the stomach, but they won't reach the along stomach part near the lesser curvature because of the presence of the cardiac notch. Where is cardiac notch? It is in between the fundus and the cardiac end of the stomach. So they won't come near the lesser curvature. So on contraction, there is an increase of the gastroesophageal angle. Means between the esophagus and the gastric stomach, we have an angle that is near the cardiac notch. So the angle is increased, helping with which prevents the reflex of the food substances into the esophagus. So because of this, the inverted oblique muscle fibers are not reaching the lesser curvatures. They form a straight band. That is a straight which the drugae are longitudinal near the lesser curvature. So because of this, with the formation of the gastric canal there. Then serous coat, of course, it is derived because we know it is the stomach is covered by the peritoneum, anterior, superior, and posterior inferior surfaces. So it is derived from the peritoneum, except near the gray area where it is present near the cardiac part of the stomach. Running out of time on the plane. Coming to the arterial supply. Coming to the arterial supply, we have main derivative because we know the stomach is derived from the foregut. So we have the artery, main artery is coming from the celiac trunk. So the branches from the celiac trunk, that is splenic artery, common hepatic artery, and the left gastric artery. So here we can see the names left gastric artery, direct branch from the celiac trunk, right gastric artery from the hepatic, or sometimes it is arising from the common hepatic, gastroduodenal artery, gastroepibloic artery, which is a branch from the splenic artery, right, and right gastroepibloic artery is a branch from the gastroduodenal. From where this gastroduodenal artery is coming, common hepatic artery will divide into hepatic and the gastroduodenal. So gastroduodenal artery gives right gastroepibloic, whereas the left gastroepibloic artery is derived from the splenic artery. And short gastric arteries are branches here arising from the splenic artery. So these short gastric arteries, they pass through the fold of peritoneum called as gastrosplenic ligament and supply the only fundus part of the stomach. The remaining right and left gastroepibloic arteries, they will be anastomosing along the greater curvature, and within the greater omentum, and then supply the anterior superior and posterior inferior surface of the stomach, and right and left gastric arteries, they will be anastomosing with each other along the lesser curvature, within the lesser omentum, and then supply along the lesser curvature, anterior superior and the posterior inferior surface of the stomach. They form submucosal plexus, then again they reach the mucosa and then supply the, they form two plexuses and supply the stomach. Then coming to the venous drainage, the veins follow the arteries. It's changing all around. Veins follow the arteries, so mainly they drain into the portal vein. Right and left gastric veins, they drain into the portal vein. Short gastric and the left gastroepiploic, they drain into the splenic vein. Because we know the splenic vein artery gives short gastric arteries and left gastroepiploic artery, of course, they have to drain into the splenic vein. Right gastroepiploic drains into the superior mesenteric vein, and we also see portocaval anastomosis near the lower end of the esophagus, where we can, in case of the portal obstruction, there are chances of formation of esophageal varices, and which leads to, sometimes the varices may rupture, which leads to hematemesis or blood vomiting, what we say. So this picture shows you about the blood arterial supply and the venous drainage of the stomach. And coming to the lymphatic drainage, we have some group of lymph nodes along the lesser curvature and the greater curvature. So along the greater curvature, we have pancreatic splenic group of lymph nodes. Along the lesser curvature, left gastric nodes. Near the greater curvature, nearer to the pyloric end, we have right gastroepiploic nodes, pyloric nodes, and right gastric nodes, and finally all of them drain into the celiac node. So this stomach, we can divide it into two halves, right halves and the left half, by drawing an imagine along the long axis of the stomach, and the left half of the stomach again divided into upper part and the lower part. Right half of the stomach is also divided into upper part and the lower part. So the left half of the stomach, upper part, drains into the pancreatic splenic group of lymph nodes. Lower half of the left stomach will drain into the right gastroepiploic group of lymph nodes. Left side, I'm saying about the left side. Left half of the stomach into the upper part drains into the pancreatic splenic group of lymph nodes. Samely, left half of the stomach, lower part drains into the right pancreatic group of lymph nodes. Then coming to the right side, we have upper part and lower part again. Upper part drains into the left gastric group of lymph nodes. Then the lower part drains into the right hepatic group of lymph nodes, or right gastric group of lymph nodes. Finally, all of them drain into the celiac group of lymph nodes. It is supplied by the 5 minutes. Then coming to the nerve supply, it is a visceral organ, so it is supplied by the autonomic nervous system, that is sympathetic and parasympathetic group of nerves. So parasympathetic usually comes from the vagus in the form of anterior and posterior vagal trunks or anterior and posterior gastric nerves. Whereas sympathetic, so we said celiac trunk is there, so around that the plexus are seen. So the nerves are derived, from the fibers coming from the lateral horns, anterolateral horns of the spinal cord at the level of T6 to T9 in the form of greater splanchnic nerve, which goes through the celiac plexuses and through the gastric plexuses. So in this, what is the function? Sympathetic nervous system helps in vasomotor and stimulates our motor to the pyloric sphincter. Means it will not allow to open the pyloric sphincter. It inhibits the remaining gastric musculature and sensory. It carries the pain sensations from the stomach. Whereas a parasympathetic is secretomotor to the gastric glands, inhibits the pyloric sphincter and increases the motility of the stomach. And sensory, it carries the sensations of the hunger and nausea. Then the anterior vagal trunk, that is the parasympathetic vagus nerve, right? It is otherwise often that we are calling it as the anterior vagal trunk or anterior gastric trunk, which is derived from the left gastric artery, so we said obliquely placed. No, so anterior surface related to the left vagus nerve, posterior surface related to the right vagus nerve. So anteriorly vagal trunk, so it has maximum fibers from the left vagus and few fibers from the right vagus. So they are again divided into hepatic branch, celiac branch, and the gastric branch, or now to attach it. Hepatic branches will go and supply the liver and the gallbladder. Celiac branch will go and join the celiac plexuses, whereas the gastric branch is the one which is going to supply the stomach. Along the lesser curvature, supplies the anterior surface of the stomach till the as far as the pylorus of the stomach. Posterior vagal trunk, that is behind the stomach, so large amount is derived from the right vagus, a small part is derived from the left vagus. So the branches here are called as nerve of Grassi, celiac branch and gastric branch or nerve to blood arteries. So nervus glossi is the one which is going to supply the fundic part of the stomach. Celiac branch again joins the celiac ganglion. Gastric or nerve to blood arteries supplies the along the lesser curvature to the posterior surface of the stomach. So applied aspects. So gastritis, so inflammation in the stomach is called gastritis. So visualization is called gastroscope and the procedure is called as gastroscopy. If the gastric pain, usually we find pain felt in the epigastric region. Again, reason is they are derived from T6 to T9. So the epigastric region is also supplied by the fibers arising from T6 to T9. So the pain will be referred to the epigastric region. Gastric ulcers usually along the lesser curvature. Carcinoma of the stomach is along the greater curvature of the stomach. Carcinoma, right? Vagotomy means selective vagotomy or highly selective vagotomy or vagal truncal vagotomy. Pyloric stenosis means the thickening of the muscle fibers, circular muscle fibers at the pyloric end of the stomach is called as pyloric stenosis. It is congenital defect with neuromuscular incoordination of the pyloric sphincter. You can see the images of the gastric ulcers there. Pyloric stenosis, gastric carcinoma. So this is again the carcinoma of the stomach can spread to the other parts of the body also through the lymphatic drainage. So again, the signal nodes which are present in the left supraclavicular. So that will be inflamed. So this is called as Strauss nodes or Virchow's nodes. So that sign will be seen in case of the gastric carcinoma. So here you can see the vagotomy. Why vagotomy means again? In case of peptic ulcers, okay, so HCl secreted or the person is suffering from peptic ulcers, so HCl has to be reduced. So to do that, we have to go for truncal vagotomy. Truncal vagotomy means both the nerves have to be cut before giving the branches. So selective vagotomy means they have to go, they have to leave the hepatic branch of the vagus, anterior and posterior vagal trunks, and then the nerve attaches has to be cut. Whereas highly selective means we have to see the nerve specified nerve, that is nerve of Grassi, which is going to supply the fundic part. And we know in the fundic part only, we have the peptic parietal cells which secrete the HCl. So that has to be cut so that the remaining part of the stomach will be having the normal function.